in whose interest do you exercise it? To whom are you accountable? I can't remember the fourth one, but the final test was, how could they get rid of you? And he famously quipped, you know, if you can't answer that last one successfully, we don't live in democracy. So I would say that's my priority, is to democratise decisions about land. I mean, democratise sounds a very theoretical thing, but it's basically some of the things I've been saying. Give more people the right to inherit land, for example. Make the tax system more accountable to local people. Make the information about land more transparent and more open. Give people greater democratic control over things that happen in their own community, including land. That's all about democratising land. So that would be my priority. But I wouldn't ever sit here and tell you what I thought we should do in detail, because actually this is a decision we should take collectively. I mean, this is collectively our country, and we should decide in a democratic fashion how we should do it. And some of my ideas may not be ideas that are supported by the wider population, I don't know. So I'm always reluctant to provide blueprints, because I think they're potentially very dangerous.
So if I can just ask a couple of questions. One of them is, as far as I understand it, the EU subsidies to farmers comes to the UK government and is then divided across the UK in a way that was never intended by the EU. As I understood it, the targeting of poor arable land and poor grazing land was to be more heavily subsidised than a patch of barley in the south of England. Is that true in your understanding? And is there anything that the government can do in this next round of the EU negotiations to try and protect farmers and give them a better deal in Scotland?
No, that's not my understanding. I mean, obviously the UK is the member state, so cap payments always go to the member state. They always go directly to the member state. And in each member state, there is different levels of devolution of decision-making about how that money is spent. So the United Kingdom, the devolved administrations of Wales, Scotland, Northern Ireland have substantial devolved competence over how it's spent, and therefore the system of cap subsidy system in Scotland is different from what it is in England. It's been different since 1999. So we can design large elements, but you can only design it within the framework provided by the EU regulation. So EU sets the parameters, and you can only have flexibility within those parameters. But that flexibility is given to Edinburgh. In terms of the future, I mean, at the moment we're looking at coming out of the EU at the end of March 2019. So we have to, and because the EU withdrawal bill that was published on Wednesday or Thursday proposes to take all those EU competencies, things that we've had no control over. So in Holyrood we've had to abide by EU law, that is the law. In Westminster they've had to abide by EU law, that is the law. If you're a member state, you have to abide by the law of the EU. They're proposing to take all that body of EU law into Westminster. And we'll only be able to change that in areas that we would be able to change it now. So all the bits of agriculture that are part of EU law, we should come straight to Holyrood, won't. They'll come to Westminster and then they'll decide, they're saying, by negotiation. I mean, Mike Russell was on the Sunday Politics this morning saying this is not the way it should work, obviously, and I agree with him. They should come to the devolved administrations, and then we work across the United Kingdom, or indeed the British Isles as a whole, including Ireland, to come to develop a new common market. Because obviously you do need it. It would be bad if England had lower regulatory standards than we did. I mean, that's bad for trade, it's bad for business. We should seek to, but the best way to keep those uniform standards, obviously, is to stay in the EU. But yeah, who knows if that's going to happen. But we're in a state of vast flux at the moment, and where almost anything can happen. So there's no answer to your second question.
My other question was to do with land value tax. I'm very interested in seeing how that might be put further up the agenda? Are there ways in which we can encourage it?
Yeah, well, we've always believed in it as a party. And what we put at the Holyrood elections, which I think is still a workable model, is we said local tax, and this is not just council tax, this is non-domestic rates as well, we said that all land should be valued, even if it's not rated. So if you want to keep agriculture out of non-domestic rates, that's fine, but at least have it valued so we know the cost of the tax exemption we're giving. Because it's important for politicians to say, well, we can't afford to spend more money in NHS, but look, here's £500 million of tax that we're letting farmers get away with, or empty industrial buildings get away with. We need those figures. We can't have those figures if they're not on a valuation roll. So the first thing we said was have a complete valuation roll, the whole country, so we know what all the land's worth. Second thing we said was split that value, so there's land values and property values are separate, like they do in Denmark. So a piece of vacant land would just have a site value. A piece of land next door to it with a factory on it would have the same site value, probably, but then it would have a value of the building as well. And let local authorities, and the third thing we said, let local authorities who levy these taxes and give the non-domestic rate back to local authorities. By the way, let's not have a central rate set by Edinburgh, and that was a Thatcher. Thatcher centralised the rates in 1889. Let's give that back to local authorities. So local authorities should be able to set their own local property taxes. But they can vary the proportion they give to the two elements, the land and the improvements. They could just bundle it all up and say it's 50-50. Or they could say we're taxing the buildings more than the land. Or if it was a green council, we'd say we tax the land 100% and not tax the buildings at all. And that would be land value tax. In other words, doing a universal valuation, splitting the value, gets you to a point where implementation becomes much easier. And we want to do that because it's kind of a ridiculous situation where if you own a property and there's going to be a One Homes Bill introduced in Parliament to try and improve energy efficiency in buildings, and you improve the energy efficiency of your home, and as a result it increases in value, at the moment that means when you sell it, it'll be subject to a higher level of tax. It should be anyway, if you've got put into a council tax band. That, to my mind, is stupid. We should be encouraging people to improve property with no penalty. And land value tax does that because it doesn't impose any tax at all on property. It's just on the land, and the land wouldn't change. The land value wouldn't change if you improve the energy efficiency of your house. So we still think there's a lot of merit in it, and we're having discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance on this topic, but there's a lot of resistance to these kind of ideas from the usual reinvested interests.
Hello.
Yes.
How does the land value versus property thing work for flats?
It's very straightforward. The land, obviously, if you have a piece of land that has got permission for building one house on it, that land will be worth less than the land that's got permission to build eight flats on it. Okay? But for the eight flats, they take an eighth each of the value of the site on which the flats sit. So it's you simply apportion it. It's quite straightforward. And as I say, people think this is complex, and I've stood up in the chamber and had debates, and MSPs have stood up, oh, it cost 8 million to even revalue the council tax. You know, the council tax, you're still paying based on values in 1991. And I said to the First Minister on more than one occasion, you know, if we did that with income tax, you'd be paying no tax at all, because Nicola Sturgeon was a law student in 1991. We don't do that with income. We don't do it any other tax. You know, I go out and buy something in the shops, I pay VAT at its current price. I don't pay the VAT that I would have paid at its price in the shops in 1991. So it's silly to round in the evaluation, but I can't remember what I was going to say here now. So people say this is very complicated and it'll cost a lot of money. That's mainly because the way we do valuations at the moment is very archaic. So the way we did council tax valuations when the poll tax was abolished was surveyors, the assessors, the valuers and the valuation offices drove around the country in vehicles, and they just drove down the street and said, oh, that's all band C, that's band D, that's band A. We don't know about that one, we'll have to come back to it. That's how they did it. They just drove around using their eyes, because they were talking about very wide bands of values. An experienced valuer can usually put a property into a wide band. But Estonia, for example, had to build itself from scratch after it became independent in 1992. It basically had to build the apparatus of a modern democratic state from nothing, because it had the Soviet legacy. And one of the consequences of the Baltic states' independence and their need to build a modern state has they've embraced modern technology. So the Baltic states now are the source of a lot of modern technology. Skype is the famous one invented in Estonia, I think. Now, we could buy from Estonia for probably about, well, I hesitate to put a price on it, but probably cost under £1 million. We could buy the software system they've developed to value the whole of Estonia. And they do it overnight. They do it at 1 o'clock in the morning. So it's done automatically. Every day there's property selling in Estonia. Obviously people are buying and selling property every day. And all those sale prices go into a logarithm that works out, well, if this house is selling for that, then the house that's half the price will have sold for that. And the valuation is updated. And it's done automatically. So we could embrace modern technology to do a lot of this kind of stuff, instead of which we inherit basically a Victorian state that doesn't do things. We don't even have an open modern land register. You know, you should be able to go online now and find out all those bits of information I said that you could find out about the state of Montana. You can't. Well, you could, but it'll take you best part of a week. And it'll cost you money.
Can I just add to that? Yeah. I'll just add to that that if you think finding out about land ownership is difficult, finding out about land ownership and women and land ownership is like 10 times more difficult. It's really difficult.
Are things not really changing though quite quickly? I'm just thinking about shooting estates and people who own shooting estates. It looks at the moment as if a lot of the shooting is reducing quite significantly. I don't know if that's about austerity or what have you. Where we are, for example, they've stopped a lot of the corporate shoots that used to charge £5,000 a day for, and the pheasants and what have you, where we are, we're just at the foot of Glen Sheen. That stopped the last 3 years. They no longer have the gamekeepers and what have you. Is that the case throughout Scotland? Is the, you know, the kind of the drive, if you like, to have these big shooting estates as relevant now as it has been, or is it just archaic?
Well, it's okay, but I mean, it's changed over the years. So they started as the playthings of Victorian industrialists, and obviously they've changed over the years. Now, I think you're probably right. I don't know the answer, but certainly, as the financial boom took place up until the crash in 2008, there was bundles of silly money being spent on corporate hospitality by banks and finance houses, which often involved flying to Scotland and shooting things. And all that money's gone. I mean, you know, the financial crash has wiped out that kind of excess that we saw in companies like RBS. So that trend is probably a trend that's more widespread. But there's still a lot of new money coming in. I mean, a record was set just a few months ago of the sale of the Tulkin estate in Speyside by, bought by a Russian oligarch, the person that owns Stolichnaya Vodka. So he's one of the oligarchs, multi-billionaire. He owns it. More and more Russians are coming in. So there's always, in an unregulated property market, where anyone from anywhere in the world can come and buy land, which is what Scotland is, and what makes it kind of unique, there'll be always money somewhere in the world. if it's not the Russians tomorrow, it'll be the Chinese. There'll always be a market for that. Because there's virtually nowhere else they can come and buy such extensive areas of land, no questions asked. So this is not going to go away, even though the character might be changing a little bit. Incidentally, the Stolichnaya Vodka guy did an interesting thing, because there were tenant farmers on that estate who, under the 2003 Land Reform Legislation, or Agricultural Holdings Act, have the right to buy their farm if and when it's sold. But they got round it because the estate was owned by Tulkin Sporting Estates Limited, and it's still owned by Tulkin Sporting Estates Limited. So the estate wasn't sold. It was the shares in the company that owned the estate were sold. And we still don't know who the shareholder is because Company's House hasn't been updated, but it's probably an offshore trust that owns the shares. In other words, ownership hasn't changed, although the beneficial ownership has changed, and that meant because ownership couldn't change, the tenant farmers didn't get the right to buy. And those are the kind of, in fact, that was the last blog I wrote, I think, back in August last year, apart from a few things that were going on around defamation. the fact is, we need more, you know, that stuff needs to be the subject of local knowledge in Speyside, in Moray Council. People should be talking about that, should be debating it. There should be motions and letters going to Scottish Government saying, could you amend or change the law so these tenant farmers get the right to buy, we could close this loophole, etc. But it's still not happening, because I think still in Scotland we live in a very genteel society where people feel it's not their position to stand up and make a fuss. And I think we need much, much more active social movements. So for example, the question of women and inheriting land, where is the social movement in Scotland demanding this? There's thousands, well, exactly, right? Yeah, I know about maybe a dozen people like you who raise these kind of questions, but there'll be thousands and thousands across Scotland. Get ready, there could be a succession bill tomorrow. Actually, I don't think there will be, because the Scottish Government's very nervous about it, but there will be one soon. You need to be ready. You need to know exactly the kind of changes you want, which causes you want change, to what effect. That's a very good example of where we need to be more active. And the more people that are active, and now we've got, there's no, you know, excuse me, we can do this stuff really easily now because we've got social media, we've got the internet, we've got websites, we've got everything. It's never been easier to mobilise large numbers of people around political demands and communicate those demands to the people that matter. Yeah, I could pull up my phone here and show you the number of emails I'm getting from people. I just got one before I came in demanding that I don't support the repeal of the Offensive Behaviour of Football Act, and if I do, they'll never vote for me again. Well, they probably never voted for me in the first place. But the stuff's pouring in all the time, puppy dogs' tails or railway policing or whatever. We're getting lots and lots of communications, but I haven't had one single communication of what you're going to do about women's rights. In fact, probably most MSPs haven't.
Andy has to go now, and I think all that leaves me to say is to thank you very much on behalf of everybody here. I think we've found this afternoon fascinating, very informative, and I'm sure we're all going to have things to talk about going forward. The one thing you didn't talk about in terms of mobilising people power, this is really what we're all about. It's not an SNP or a Green or a Labour movement. The movement of yes now, yes to, or whatever, is about non-party politics, but people power. And one thing I'd like everybody to see just before you go is that a couple of guys over the last 3 years, they've developed a piece of kit which, you know, Andy was talking about £1 million worth of software. They've developed an app. It's called the Indie App. If you've got an Apple phone or a Google phone, you can get that just by going to the website. It's free to download. But what it's done, it already has 110 local groups across the whole of Scotland signed up as a group. And each of these groups has individual members. In Blairgowrie and Rattray, we have our own group set up on the app. and every individual member can automatically become part of that group. It's very secure. The only